I hear the chariot coming today. I am King Kong. I'm King Kong. I'm King Kong. I'm King Kong.
Hey guys, Filmcrazyadam here, and welcome to another Went to the Movies review. I am about to head off and go see Kong Skull Island. Now, like I mentioned in last week's review, which I know I didn't get around to posting, so it's actually going to be posting this week at the same time as this review. This is the movie review where I first do a review before going to the movies, so you get my thoughts going into it, and then I come back from the movie and give you like the more traditional review, which is after the movies. So you get my before and after, so you know where my head's at going in, and then of course coming out of it. So where am I going into this movie? Well, from my understanding and from the movie poster, which if you've seen the movie poster on this movie, what's the deal with the five soldiers like Jesus walking across the water? What am I looking at? To those listening on my podcast, you know, just look up the movie poster. What the F am I looking at there? But let's not like, get bogged down in minutia like that. Going into it, and the real piece of information that I'm pulling from the poster is that it says from the producers of Godzilla, the 2014 Godzilla with Ken Akamatsu and Bryan Cranston, and that was about it for good acting in that movie. And even Ken Akamatsu was a little bit hammy and not great. So, if anyone saw the 2014 Godzilla movie or saw my review for it, I enjoyed it for what it was. Like, it was not this isn't a great movie, at least I believe. This is 3 years ago. But I was saying that it's a Godzilla movie. Like, if you've ever seen your traditional Japanese Toho company Godzilla movie, this is what it is. This was an American version of that, and I thought it was done really well. But in the end, it was still a Godzilla movie. Now, on that note, this King Kong movie is from the producers of that movie, and I've heard tell that this movie is to set up, well, I don't know if directly set up, but at the very least, basically establish. This is to establish King Kong in the world, in specifically that world with Godzilla in it, so that next year they can have a King Kong versus Godzilla movie like they had in Japan. So this movie is to establish and thus set up and make way for King Kong versus Godzilla. So, at least that's what I understand. That's what I understand, what I've read. This movie looks good. Visually, it looks fantastic. You know, and it seems to have a really good cast. Like, all people I really like. Tom Hiddleston, of course, from the MCU, Loki. John Goodman, Sam Jackson, John C. Reilly. So it's got a lot of people I like, and a lot of really good actors. And you know, Sam Jackson is usually a really good judge of scripts if they're going to be SE or not. So visually, I'm like, wow, this looks really good. And they don't try to hide it and try to pretend it's not a King Kong movie. Like, they show him right away. They're like, here he is. It's a giant monkey. So right off the bat, you know, this isn't a mystery movie. And it appears that they're not, like, remaking the original from 1939? The 1930s. I want to say it's 33. But they're not, this isn't a remake of that, kind of like the 2005 King Kong was, that Peter Jackson directed. Pretty sure it was 2005. But, like I said, this is just to establish Kong. You know, they're going to Skull Island, they got Apache helicopters, they're flying in, they got machine guns, so this is all modern times, they're going to this island. That said, I don't know what this movie is about. Usually when you go see a trailer for a movie, Or the purpose of a trailer is to kind of give you an idea of what you're getting into, or at the very least give you a taste and kind of, you know, maybe a little bit of a question, and that pulls you in. You want to go to this movie to discover what the hell did I just see in that trailer? Like, it looks like, let's see, there's a prince and an evil wizard, and you know, the evil wizard casts a spell on a kingdom. Huh. Or maybe he's not a prince, he's just like this shadowy warrior or just like a thief, and like, you're like, huh, I wonder how this thief is going to defeat this evil wizard. You know, stuff like that. Trailer's supposed to give you a question and an idea and pull you in. This, I don't know what the movie's about, other than Apache helicopters go to this island, and it seems that they, not, like, going into it, these mercs or these army men don't know what they're getting themselves into. It appears that John Goodman's character, knows what's up, like, knows that there's a giant monkey there. I don't know why, and, like, they start, like, dropping daisy cutters or something on the island. I don't know what this movie's about. I think Tom Hiddleston is some kind of reporter or some kind of journalist. Sam Jackson is obviously a merc or an army guy. I think it's army. John C. Reilly is a crazy guy that, you know, he's the crazy guy that got stranded on the island, and, you know, so now he knows things about the islands, but he's kind of crazy too. So I don't know what's happening with this movie. I don't know what the story is. I don't know what they're planning. Are they planning to take Kong off the island? Are they planning to just, you know, nuke the island, turn it into a parking lot, and like build some resorts? Oh, I have no idea going into this movie. Now I do like I do like monster movies to a degree, especially the classics like King Kong and Godzilla, and so I'm drawn to this movie. Not only because it's a King Kong movie, because, I mean, those are just, you know, that's the sort of thing that I'm like, giant monkey movie, but specifically the story of King Kong, I'm like, all right, I like these movies, you know, or at the very least, I find them entertaining, usually more for storytelling than anything. I'm getting off topic now, but anyway, going into this movie, where was my thoughts? Well, I'm kind of excited because it's an action movie, fantasy, sci-fi, I don't know what you would call it, but fiction. There's going to be action to it, there's going to be explosions to it. It looks like there's going to be some intense fights with King Kong, with not just the people, but also the creatures. Oh, no, I do remember something from the trailer. There's like a pit or something, or like there's like a hole, like a dimensional hole or something in the middle of the island, and Kong basically is the guard, the warden. He's the one that he watches for creatures to come out of this pit, and then he kills them, I guess. So like I said, I don't know where we're going with this. He's gonna beat up monsters that come out of this hole in the earth, and maybe it'll kind of lay some groundwork and story work, and like, well, that's where Godzilla came from. That's where all these other creatures came from. I don't know. Maybe I'm just talking out my ass, and I'm not remembering the trailer correctly. But I'm still excited. I want to see this movie. I'm curious to see where we go with this. And if it does tie in with Godzilla, I'm curious to see how they do that. So, that's my mindset going in. I'm looking forward to it. I'm expecting good things from specifically those four actors that I named. I'm expecting good acting. I don't know what the story is, not really, so, you know, I'm kind of jumping in blind on that one. But I'm still excited, because I'm going to give it a shot, and I'm optimistic with the way movies have been coming out this year so far. I haven't gone to the theater yet and not been entertained or loved it, so let me go see this movie now. I'll be back, and I'll let you know what I think when I come back. All right, later. Well, I'm back from seeing Kong Skull Island. Well, this is the first movie this year that I've gone to, and I walk out with it going, well, that was a waste. I don't know what the Rotten Tomatoes score is. I don't really care what the Rotten Tomatoes score is because I don't really give that any credence. It seems very arbitrary, and like bad movies seem to get good reviews. Like, when you get a billion just people going, oh, I love the movie, even though they're not really looking at it they're more blown away by the fact that there was CG on screen than the actual story and the actual continuity and things that make, you know, sense in telling a good story. Well, I'm pretty sure this movie scored high. I know it's like a 4.5. I think it was like a 4.5 stars out of 5 on when I booked the movie through Fandango. But God, this was I was very disappointed. This movie wasn't good. I know people are going to tell me, well, what wasn't good about it? If you're looking for just a monster movie where giant monsters fight each other, this isn't a good one for that. If you're looking for a good character movie, this one isn't a good one for that. If you're looking for a movie that makes sense, this isn't a good one for that. I got bored in this movie. Maybe about the halfway point, I finally just got tired and bored. And the only interesting thing, and even this I wasn't, like, impressed with, was there's a post-credit scene, and that's the scene where they tie these two movies together. Alright, so if anyone's asking, what's Filmcrazyadam's opinion of this movie? It was stupid. It was, I don't know what this movie was going for. I don't know what they were trying to do with this movie. That's it. Like, I'm walked out like, alright, why did we do that? I don't get it. Other than to establish that there's other giant monsters out there for Godzilla to fight. Like, what was the point of all that? Because the movie technically starts in 1944. There's an American fighter pilot and a Japanese fighter pilot. They both go down on Skull Island. They survive their crashes, and then they are, and while trying to fight each other to the death, they are then confronted by Kong. And then it jumps to 1973. And the movie had, and so here we are, 1973, you know, approximately 30, 40, like 40 some odd years before the first, before Godzilla, 40 some odd years earlier. So 1973, Vietnam is, the Vietnam War is just ending, and John Goodman plays the head of this company, of this organization called Monarch, and he wants to go to Skull Island. I don't know why. Now, I'm jumping ahead. He seems to know. It's never really revealed this because, okay, in the movie we have satellites in space at this point, and we're taking pictures from space, and this island, Skull Island, has a perpetual, never-dissipating ring of a storm in the form of a ring around this island. And I don't care, and that right there is BS. Like, perpetually, this island exists shrouded perpetually in just this hurricane wind that just, in a circle. It never dissipates, it never goes away. But you know what? Whatever. So that's why it's undiscovered. I mean, you have to explain, well, why hasn't this island been discovered? Well, it's because there's this storm front that never goes away, so no one ever goes to the island. Yet there are inhabitants of that island. You know, an island that time forgot. On this island, there are larger than regular creatures. Giant spiders. Giant ox. Bison. I think those are bison. Giant monkeys. Giant legless lizards. Well, they have arms, and they're fast and they're obnoxious. It's never established that John Goodman's character knows that there's a giant monkey on this island. It's never actually established. At one point, there seems to be an implication that he did know, but his associate, this black guy that goes with John Goodman, seemed just as clueless. Like, I didn't see that coming. Like, why is there a giant monkey here? You know, John Goodman seems to know, and yet, like, there's nothing to pre-establish it. And I'm confused because it's so confusing, this movie. Like, what were they going for? I don't know. So let's get into this. Let me really try and explain why I thought this was a bad movie, because I felt this was a bad movie. It wasn't really entertaining, and the characters were paper thin. The motivations behind them, I don't know what's... Well, no. Sam Jackson's character is just crazy. He's bloodthirsty, and... Alright. Dang. This is annoying. It's a lot harder than it was talking about Logan. And that's what happens with a bad movie, is that now I got to explain it, or I actually, like, through talking out loud to you guys, listeners and viewers, I'm kind of working it through my head also. Sometimes, you know, I'll sleep on it because I'm like, what the hell did I just watch? And this is one of those, but it was just bad. It was poorly done. It was half-assed, this movie. Everything that happened in this movie, I'm like, why are you doing that? Well, I don't get it. Why are you doing that? So, let's start with the characters. You have, and I forgot to mention, Brie Larson is in this movie, who has been in other things, none of which I can remember. However, I do know that she's going to be Miss Marvel, or Mar-Vell, in the MCU. So, yeah, I believe she's going to be in Infinity Wars, in fact. And I think at some point she's going to have her own movie. Like I said, is Miss Marvel or Miss Mar-Vell? So Brie Larson is in it. But, and that's funny because you're crossing over the MCU with Sam Jackson and Tom Hiddleston. You know, Loki and Ultimate Nick Fury. So that's cool. But anyway, so Brie Larson plays this anti-war photographer. I don't know why she was there. I mean, other than she was more interesting than most characters, but I mean, at the same time, she didn't really add anything, because after, I'm jumping a little ahead, like afterwards, she's one of the survivors. She gets off the island. She has all these pictures that were taken. Those pictures have never seen the light of day. They're going to be lit up. You know, those rolls of films are just going to be, after they're developed and put into the government's archive or monarch's archive, there's going to be, that's it. You know, those photos aren't seeing the light of day. I don't know if she's going to see the light of day. So, all right, maybe not completely useless, but, all right, whatever, moving on, bad example. Tom Hiddleston, they find him somewhere in Southeast Asia, and in a bar, in a dive bar, and by that, I mean John Goodman and his associate go to this, I don't know, they heard from somebody that he's like a good explorer or a good tracker. I think he's a tracker. And they go to this dive bar in Southeast Asia, and they find him right after he beats up these two guys who were basically trying to mug/murder him in a bar over a pool game. There's a lot of stuff I'm throwing out there, but this actually happens. So they hire him. And so he's supposed to be like kind of like this. The way I understood it, he's kind of be like this. he's supposed to be like the huntsman from Snow White and the Huntsman. You know, some guy who's been in uncharted territory and came out alive, and he's a badass. So he's got a little bit of that. He's got a little bit of Indiana Jones in him. He's got a little bit of Crocodile Dundee. You know, he's just this master. He's like Jim Bridger. He's like this master woodsman that goes in and comes out alive and just like, you know. And a little. Oh, I was going to say like Tarzan, but no, not like Tarzan. So they hire him because they're like, we're going on this island. It's never been charted before. It's completely unexplored. We need somebody who can get us on and then get us off alive. And he's like, okay. And he's like, well, and they throw down a stack of money like that thick. And he's like, and the associate's like, we can double that. And he's like, you're going to need to pay me 5 times as much and then add a bonus for what you're asking me. And so he has no idea where he's going. He's just like, if we're going someplace that's never been before, so there's no telling what kind of animals are there. You know, I've done a lot of exploring in jungles and stuff. I think that's what he's done. So you're going to need to pay me buko bucks. You know, I need... somebody else is going to look at this pile and, like, dollar signs are going to appear in their eyes. It's going to be so high. It's going to be so big. So they hire him. So, and finally, he's kind of like a merc. He's hired for cash. He's former Royal Military... British Royal Military. He, let's see. Brie Larson gets a phone call, basically, and said... There is no reason why she was there, really. Because she's a war photographer, specifically an anti-war photographer. And she gets this phone call and basically says, hey, even though that your pictures are in Time Life and like you're assured to have a picture on the cover, and you're like a shoo-in for a Pulitzer, and she's like, well, I still want this one. It's not a, just so you know, it's not a war job. Yeah, I know. But you still want it? Yeah. All right, whatever. That's how she gets the gig. She gets a phone call saying, hey, you want this gig? I don't know why this gig needs a photographer. I don't know who thought this was a good idea. Who's like, we need a photographer on this. We need to call somebody and make sure we got a photographer. Or I don't know who called her and said, hey, you should go along with this. Just in case. Like, she's a just in case. That's literally what she's there for. I don't know why she's there. I take back what I said. I don't know why she's there. You know, she takes pictures and these are pictures that we'll probably see in the next movie in the series, but ultimately it's like, why was she there? Like, she got a tip off from somebody, and she's a war photographer going to a non-war place. I don't know. I don't know why she was there. I don't know how she got the tip off. I don't know. I'm done. Now, Sam Jackson's character is probably the easiest to explain. Like I said, Vietnam has just ended. That war is over. Literally at the beginning of the movie. So, like, 1 minute into the movie, Vietnam is over. And so, American troops are being pulled out of Vietnam. Now, Sam Jackson's character is not satisfied. You know, historically speaking, in American history, Vietnam was a pretty big fail all around. Some people say it's a war that just kind of went nowhere, so there was no winners, no losers. A lot of people will say that we lost that war. In this movie, Sam Jackson's character says, we didn't lose the war, we abandoned it. And so I could, and some people could say that too. It's like, all right, yeah, that was a bad idea from start to finish. But anyway, that's not the reason why we're doing this review. We're doing this review not about the politics of the real world situation. Bottom line is the war ends, and Sam Jackson's character is not happy because he feels that, you know, he's got like a shoebox or something full of medals and dog tags. People that, you know, he's gotten awards for things, and there are people that have died under his command, and in the end, it's America. You know, America's just leaving. You know, we did not win. We left. So he looks at it as a defeat, even though he says we didn't lose. We abandoned it. He's looking at it as a defeat. He is looking at it like he screwed up somewhere along the line. Like, we effed up somewhere. This was a fail, And for a U.S. Army man like him, he's not used to losing, to failing. Like, what was the point of it? You know, he questions, he even asks in the movie, like, I ask about the movie in general. What was the point of this? What was the point of it all? Like, I'm getting all these awards, and all these people died for, you know, we're supposed to believe that they died for their country, protecting the country, but we're over here fighting for something that, you know, these are just kids. You know, they're drafted. They don't know what's, they don't want to be here. They want to be home watching baseball. They want to be going to college. They want to be driving cars. They want to be eating cheeseburgers, you know, getting a job, raising a family, living their lives. So, but the draft forced these kids here. So they had to have died for something. All this time, effort, money, life that we've put into this war, it has to have been for something. That's what's going through his mind. And so he is a little bit broken because of that. He's like, I can't believe this was all for nothing. Everything that has happened. So he's looking for something. He's looking for a win. So when he gets a phone call from his general, because John Goodman's character, after he gets the go-ahead from somebody on Capitol Hill, that guy, he says, I need a military escort. So this guy is called up in Vietnam and says, we got one last thing for your soldiers. Just so you know, you can say no. All your guys are free and clear to come home. They're, you know, it's done. It's done. Your guys are, you're free and clear. Get home and go and live your lives. So you don't have to say yes. But I've got a job for you if you're interested. And Sam Jackson's like, hell yeah. So he joins up and his crew. And maybe I missed something in this movie. So, oh, but this movie fast tracks a lot. Like, they go from they did it in faster time than I just explained it. How John Goodman goes to Capitol Hill, and then they go to Southeast Asia for Loki, and then Brie Larson gets a phone call, and then Sam Jackson gets a phone call. They did that faster than how I explained it to you in the movie. They fast-tracked. They really, they were in the express lane. They're like, we need to get to this island. So they're on this ship. It's like a container ship, but it's empty. Like, it would be one that transports, you know, shipping containers, but there's no shipping containers on it. It's just an empty deck. And for some reason, there's like 15 helicopters. No. Listen to me. And then watch the movie and then tell me I'm wrong. There was one ship that went out there, and it wasn't a military ship. I forget what it was. It wasn't a military ship, but it was like going that in that direction. And John Goodman and his people piggybacked on it. So it wasn't even a military ship. It was just a ship. I don't remember what it was going out there for. But anyway, during the trip out there, which takes like 4 minutes, you see like three helicopters on deck. Yet when it's go time and it's time to get going, there's literally 15 helicopters. And one of them is, I think it's called a Huey, the one with the two propellers on top. You know, the ones that carry like tanks and other things. Yeah, those big ones. Well, I don't know where that came from. I have no idea where these 15 helicopters, including this one Huey, and by the way, when they're like, all right, there's the storm front to the island, it's go time, you see like 15 regular helicopters lift up, you know, they're floating in the air above the ship waiting for all the others to lift off, and then they fly through this storm cloud, and then once it gets to the other side of the storm cloud, then there's a Huey with them. Like, I guess two of them crashed into each other and made... I don't know! I have no idea where that Huey came from. I have no idea where these other 13... where these other 12 helicopters came from. They couldn't physically fit on that ship unless that you had taken them apart. Which is stupid. I have no idea. And, like, when you're showing around to the crew, the crew that Sam Jackson has, you know, 15 helicopters, pilot, co-pilot, and minimum of three people on each helicopter, so minimum of five guys per helicopter, minimum. And you got 13 15 helicopters. Watch my brain have a stroke. Watch me have a stroke while I try to do math. 30, 60, 75 guys. There were not 75, and that's not including the Huey. or the crew of the ship. There was not 75 guys on that. Is my math right? 15 times 2 is 30. 30 times 2 is 60, plus another 15. So that's 5 guys, 15 helicopters. Yeah, 75. There were not 75 guys on that boat. There weren't. Even if it was just, even if it was just 3 guys per helicopter, or no, 4 guys per helicopter, you know, it's still 60 guys. There were not 60 guys on that ship. So I'm like, what? It's not adding up, man! It's not adding up! So, anyway, they arrive on the island, and John Goodman and his associate, and a few other people, scientists, during the briefing on the ship, there was like 60 people. Alright, I take that back. But there was like 60 army guys and like 60 scientists, and you only ever see like 10 scientists, unless they all stayed on the boat. Bottom line, 120 people, you never see them on this boat during the trip over to the island. You never see 120 people. It's 120 people! Oh, good God. And even then, it was like, I mean, they had to, no, the numbers, the editing, it doesn't add up. Or just the physical space that these things would have to take up, the people and the helicopters. I know I'm getting bogged down on this, but this is the sort of thing that years from now, if I ever get to that point where I can make a movie, you know, I'm trying to avoid this crap. You know, I want people to not go, wait a second, when they watch one of my movies. So, anyway, so it just doesn't add up. So anyway, and then so they get to the island. They go through the hurricane wall, and the scientists set up some computers and some measuring material, and they start dropping these seismic charges onto the island. And even Loki's like, I don't know how this makes sense. Like Loki and Marvel are at one point they go like under. Right before they lift off in helicopters, they go like under deck and look at the equipment, and both Marvel and Loki are like, huh, I wonder what this stuff is for. And that's it! Like, they look at it, they don't even say, like, huh, these are nukes, or this is napalm. This is like, wonder what this is for. And then they walk away. It's like, well, there's so many scenes in this movie where I'm like, wait, was there a point when they did that? What was the point of that? Was that a thing? And like later I'm like, did it matter that they looked at these boxes? No, it didn't. It didn't. So anyway, they set up all this computer equipment, and then they start bombing the island. And the whole end, you know, the scientists are measuring, and they're like, yeah, we're just mapping the underneath of the island. Because, like, the seismic charges, which, by the way, are dropped at random. Like, it's never established, like, okay, we need to drop one here, and then 2 clicks north, and then 2 clicks north. You know, there's no pattern. They're just dropping these effing bombs randomly over the island. So I don't know how they're supposed to get any, like, real, actual data, like anything reliable or anything accurate, but they're just bombing this island, and then King Kong starts throwing palm trees at the helicopters and just destroys this entire fleet, this entire squadron of helicopters, including the Huey. And at this point, I don't care if I'm saying it wrong, I probably am. Somebody's gonna be like, you're an idiot because you don't know what the two-bladed helicopter is. Fine, I'm an idiot for not knowing it too late, but I think it's a Huey. But anyway, all these helicopters, literally all of them, destroyed. And I don't blame Kong. You're bombing my home. I'm gonna kill you back. Just like Captain Reynolds said, if anyone tries to kill you, you try to kill them right back. I don't blame Kong. The character of Kong in this movie is in many ways an afterthought. It's he shows up, they establish him, he destroys these helicopters, and he walks away. You know, he's like, well, took care of that problem, and walks away. And then he just does his thing. You know, he gets a drink of water, and then gets something to eat in the form of this giant, in the form of a kraken. which I don't know how this kraken, I mean, he fights with this octopus or a kraken or a giant squid in like, I don't know, 10 feet of water? Seriously, like, or like 15 feet of water? I mean, I guess maybe a kraken if it's not moving, if it's just sitting there. But, yeah, like, he's walking through this water, and this thing that, like, is the size of a school. I mean, this giant freaking squid, kraken, octopus thing. This giant, this Cthulhu-esque monster, like, cover, like, enough that, like, it's a fight for Kong. It's not a long fight, but it's a fight where it's like crushing him. It's like covering him. Like, I've seen hentai with less tentacles than this fight with Kong. And then he just crushes his head and he just starts eating it like it's sushi or like it's a okonomiyaki or like, he's just eating it, whatever. And he walks away. There are these lizard things that don't have any hind legs. They have front legs and they're really fast and they got serpentine tails and they got they have like a head like Cubone, you know, the Pokemon, or yeah, where it's like its head is a skull, and it has a tongue that has like a chameleon tongue that shoots out, and has its own little tentacles on the end of it, so it can like grab things. Yeah, that was weird. But so like. So anyway, they bomb this island. They bomb just this section of the island. And the scientists are like, hey, we're getting really good readings. And one guy calls John Goodman on a phone, like literally the size of my dehumidifier here. And he's like, you would not believe it. According to the seismic charges, the island is basically hollow. It's like, all right, man, good. But they're not there for a survey. They're not. They're there. I mean, they kind of say like we're here for a survey, but at the same time, John, like I said, like John Goodman basically establishes like we knew that something was here, but I didn't say I knew, but we knew. There's other monsters. The entire underlying thing of John Goodman's character is that like giant monsters once ruled the Earth. And even though we haven't seen them in the last, like, 4,000 years, they're still here. And just sitting on their thumbs, checking Facebook, I don't know. But the monsters that, I don't know! They never established in this movie or the Godzilla movie, like, so what happened to the monsters? Oh, they got bored, they fell asleep. You know, maybe they're all just sitting on the can and they've got really bad constipation. And it's just taking them a while to take a big crap. I don't know. But they're just not doing anything. I don't know. I don't know. But so Sam Jackson, his entire squadron, just whoosh, gone. So he does, and in all of it, basically, two different parties land, or technically three parties. There's one guy, Jack, who has all the bombs with him. So he establishes contact. And he's like, yeah, I'm here. I'm okay. I'm the only one who survived the crash. And I'm on, like, the tallest mountain or something. I'm like, I'm the farthest away of anyone else. And Sam Jack is like, all right, we'll come get you. He's, like, 50 miles away. Literally, like, 50 miles away, like, halfway across the island. Or close to the other side of the island. He's like, all right, we're coming for you. Now, Sam Jackson, after he didn't know about this giant monkey, he gets in John Goodman's face after the monkey takes out his squadron and basically says, what the F was that? What did you just lie to us about? And John Goodman just basically says, well, there's giant monsters. And you saw them. And I don't know. I don't know if John Goodman's idea is to kill him or capture him and bring him to New York so he can climb a skyscraper. I don't know. I can't remember now. I think I was getting bored at this point. Actually, no, that was kind of exciting watching Kong take out all these helicopters and them just unleashing all the ammo they could at this guy. And, you know, it wasn't slowing him down, of course. So, anyway, so John Goodman and Sam Jackson and a bunch of other, and some of the scientists are over here. And then over here is Loki, Marvel, John Goodman's associate, another scientist, this Asian girl, I believe she was in Great Wall, among other things. I think I gotta look her up. She's cute. And some of the army guys. So this one kid, who his dad is like a mechanic, and that matters because that group finds John C. Reilly, who at the very beginning he's the guy that landed on the island with the Japanese pilot back at the prologue of the movie. So he's still there. He's been there for like 28 years, and him and the Japanese guy were putting pieces of their plane. You know, they became friends afterwards, and once you take off the uniforms and remove the flags, you know, we're all just the same. We all put our pants on one leg at a time, and we all pee yellow unless you have a liver problem, in which case you might pee brown or red, and that's not good. But you know what I'm saying. And so the two of them became fast friends, and unfortunately the Japanese guy was killed by one of these Cubone lizard things. I think they call them like skull crawlers in the movie. And so they were trying to put enough pieces of their planes together to create a boat, but they could never get it working. But this kid and Loki and Marvel, they get it working, and so they have a boat and they leave. Meanwhile, John C. Reilly, of course, has been living with the islanders on this island, who literally say nothing, and they're just there. They're NPCs. They have nothing to do with this movie. They're just there. They are there because if they weren't, John C. Reilly would have died 28 years ago, and that's it. They add nothing to the movie. Except kind of, they add nothing. John C. Reilly like says, "Oh, we go to this old boat that washed ashore and is now like their most sacred place." And it's not a temple; it's just a place where they kind of have drawings that depict things on the island, and yet that's their sacred. I don't know. It makes no sense. It's just an exposition piece, and that's how we learn about these skull creatures, these skull lizards, and we learn that Kong fights them. I mean, Kong is king on this island, but he wasn't the only giant monkey. There was a family of them. You know, this is where the species propagated, and they all died because these giant, giant lizard things killed them all. And now Kong is the last remaining giant monkey. Let's see, these lizard things show up. Wait. So then Sam Jackson and Loki's group, they make for the north of the island. Because before they left the boat, they established that the initial group was going to go in, and then refueling copters or a refueling boat, something was going to come in 3 days later on the north side of the island. So everyone's making for the north of the island. It's like 75, 80 miles away. Like, this island evidently is like the size of Rhode Island, I guess. I mean, this is a big island. Somehow nobody noticed it, or maybe that's how somebody did notice it. It's like, huh, there's a big island that we don't really remember about. Anyway, so they meet up. All right. At this point, Sam Jackson, you know, he seems a bit unstable and a bit angry, but it's towards a purpose. And of course, as we're going, like, guys get picked off almost randomly. It reminds me of the movie The Core, where people just seem to die arbitrarily. In that movie, it's like we have a crew of people, everyone's important. Up, that guy died because a rock fell on. And not if you ever seen The Core, the very first guy that dies in The Core, a rock like the length of my finger like spins down, pierces right through a NASA grade spacesuit, well, helmet, and just goes through his skull. Like this guy, this little tumbling rock goes through his helmet. Like a sniper shot, and it does the exact same thing. This just slow falling rock goes through this guy's head and like ripped. It's so stupid. But anyway, there's a guy that get killed by a giant spider, And I'm talking giant spider. It's a giant daddy long legs, basically. And the thing is like 60 feet tall or something. So its legs are like, they come down. Like, it's actually, it was actually comical. This guy's like holding up like a water bottle, taking a drink. He's like, and then like a foot goes through like his mouth and out the back of his head. And, ah, you know, and then everyone looks up and they're in this bamboo forest. So like these thin spindly legs look just like bamboo. And I don't know what the spider's deal was. Like, does the spider usually do that? Like, try to skewer people and critters? I don't know. But that's basically what it started trying to do. This guy was the only casualty. And they eventually cut its legs and shot it and killed it. The guy... So, let's see. Another guy gets picked up by, like, baby pterodactyls or something. And just gets... He gets flown off, and then one of his arms gets ripped off. We don't actually see him die, but he's dead. He's dead. But, I mean, it's just like, okay, he's gone for some reason. I don't know. I guess we had to fire him, so we killed him. I don't know. It's like, why was that guy? Like, that was another guy. And most of these guys that die, you're like, why was he there? It's like, you're like, which one was that? I don't remember. Did that guy even have a name? What? Who was that guy? Was he even in any other scenes? Was that just an extra that, like, they're like, here, stand right here. You're going to get killed off now. Because I don't remember that guy at all. Now, the guy who is over with the munitions, the guy who's, like, all the way up in the north part of the island, Jack, he gets eaten by one of them lizard, one of those lizard skull things. And so, anyway... That's kind of Sam Jackson's story. It's like, after they meet up with Loki, they're like, we gotta go and rescue our guy. He's established where he is. We gotta go get him. I'm not leaving a man behind. And Loki, by the way, this master tracksman, he never does anything that you're like, huh, he's like, he never does anything that like shows his skill as a tracker. He never actually does anything to establish that he's a tracker or that he's an outdoorsman. He just kind of gives like good ideas, like, we should not be here. Like, it's like, we should leave. He's never like, yeah, that's poisonous, or up, oh, that's a trap, or I feel like there's a critter around here. Sorry, one second. Forgot to plug this in. There we go before the battery dies. That was silly of me. But anyway, he never establishes that he's actually any kind of tracker. He doesn't do anything. Time. In some cases, time. Like, the first day they're on this island, they do so much in that first day. That day lasts for like 19 hours of daylight before nightfall. And then... There's a scene where Loki's like to his group of people. He's like, "Stay here. I gotta check up there." After they got on the boat and they're going up river, they stopped because I think they established that they were getting close to Sam Jackson's group, and so they stopped the boat. They got off the river, and then they got kind of turned around. And he's like, "All right, you guys stay here. I'm gonna run up there, and I just gotta look and you know, to higher ground and see where we're at, where the river is. Somehow we gotta turn around. I gotta see where we are." So him and Marvel go up, run into King Kong. King Kong's like, "What's up?" And then walks away. But it's day when they leave, and by the time they get up to this ridge, it is night. And we're not talking about sun is setting. We're talking about stars are out. It is nighttime. And then they go back. There's another scene a little bit later on where it's dark. It might be the same night where they tell the scientists on the boat. They're like, "We need to. Like, we're getting off the boat. Stay here. Unless if we're not back by dawn, go." And then again, it's like the middle of the night, and then dawn happens like that. Like, at one point, they're sitting there, and it's like, up, the sun's three quarters of the way up in the sky. I guess it's dawn. That's stupid. But, so they meet up with Sam Jackson. And Sam Jackson's like, "All right, we need to go find our guy." And John C. Reilly's character is a little weird, but he was the best character in the movie. John C. Reilly's was the best character in the movie. I love John C. Reilly's character in this movie. Well, him in general is good, but in this movie especially. And he was funny. Some of the lines weren't as funny, but like he was overall the most entertaining thing in this movie. And yeah, there's that one point where Sam Jackson's like, we have to get our guy. He's on the other side of this mass grave of giant monkeys. And John C. Reilly's like, no, we can't go that way. Your guy's, he's got to be dead. And if not, he will be soon. We should not be here. And Sam Jackson's like, we're going to get him. And John's like, yeah, you know, I've been here 28 years. What do I know? Because he's like, we can't be over here. This is where the giant skull lizards are. This is their territory. You know, they killed all the giant monkeys. And meanwhile, like, you've seen Kong beat up a few of them, and he's like, yeah, there's some small ones that come up to the surface, but there's one big one that Kong can't possibly beat. And, you know, it's impossible. If it comes above ground, you know, Kong's effed, and the world is effed, because he's the only thing keeping the species in check. He's the natural predator of this ecosystem. He's keeping the species in check. If he leaves, if he dies, then this whole species is going to propagate and it's going to take over the world. And anyway, another John Goodman's character at this point gets eaten by, this is stupid. John Goodman has a camera with a flashbulb on it. And he gets, while they're crossing this mass grave, which has like dust clouds around it, he gets eaten by one of these lizard things. And the camera is malfunctioning, and the flashbulb keeps popping and flashing. And John Goodman is eaten! And the way that they keep track of it, like, this creature evidently is just running around circles around them for some reason. Silently, by the way. But this skull lizard thing is just running circles around this group of people in this dust cloud. Again, I don't know why it's running around, because we know it is, because John Goodman's camera, it keeps flashing, despite the fact that he's been eaten, and like you see the flashbulb in its mouth, then down its throat, then down further on its throat, all the way down to its stomach, and then you could still see it flashing through its effing stomach. This is like a 5 volt bulb. I mean, from 1973. I mean, this thing is not putting off a lot of light, let alone enough to flash through, you know, lizard skin, really big, really thick lizard skin, but we know, it's stupid, why, dang it, like the flash on my camera probably, you know, the flash on my phone, which, I mean, this is an LED, this is a good flash, that probably wouldn't flash through skin, it doesn't flash through human skin, which I'm pretty sure is a lot thinner than lizard skin, so. But anyway, it keeps malfunctioning within this lizard and keeps flashing. And so we see it flash over here, then over here, then over here, then over there, and then over there. And it's like, this lizard's just running around them, silent as a ninja. It's just running around them. And then at one point it stops, and of course you see the flash over here, so obviously it's going to strike. And god dang it. And then I think Kong shows up and kills it, I think. But anyway, yeah, Kong shows up and kills it, and No, he doesn't. It gets blown up. Because there's a lot of natural gas in this death pit. In this mass grave death pit, there's a lot of natural gases. Because a guy like lights a cigarette, throws it away, and it blows up. For some reason, it didn't blow up when he lit the cigarette. But the cigarette did. So, I think Marvel, when the lizard first shows up, or maybe this is a different one altogether. No, there were two lizards. I don't know what happened to the other lizard. Wow, I just saw this movie. That shows you how bored I was at this point. I'm like, alright, I guess. But there were two lizards. One, because one hacks up. He's eaten Jack, the guy at the munitions helicopter. They've eaten him. And he hacks up Jack's skull like a cat with a hairball. And his dog tags are still around the skull's not neck for some reason. And, you know, Loki grabs that. And after they kill one or both of these lizard things, Loki said, you know, Sam Jackson's like, we still gotta keep going! You know, get our guy! And Loki's like, no, he's dead. See, I got his dog tags. He was eaten by that one over there. We should go back. And Loki's like, Loki and Marvel and the people in their group are the, and John C. Reilly are the only smart people on his island. Well, the other soldiers are smart too, but they're following orders. Actually, there's this one guy. The guy that gets blown up with grenades, and he's kind of weird. But everyone else is like, we should get off the island. And as soon as it's established that Jack is dead, it's like, we should go right now. We should go back. Hell, I didn't even want to come get him. Like, nothing against the guy, and I understand no man left behind, but I mean, we're on an island with giant monkeys and lizards that are killing us. We need to leave. You know, it'll cost us our lives or more. There's 10 of us, and it's going to cost 8 lives to save one life. And there's no telling that he's going to be alive. And once we get there, if we can get out of there alive, it's bad. It's a bad situation to be in, especially if you're that guy up there. So Sam Jackson's like, no, we're still going to keep going. And I was like, what? Why? It's like, well, that has the bombs on it. I want to blow up King Kong because he killed my men. Even though we blew up his, we were bombing his island. And everyone's like, we shouldn't do that, man. This is when John C. Reilly's like, he's keeping that lizard species in check. If we go and kill him, there's nothing to stop these things from taking over the world. I don't care. I want to kill him. Like, Sam Jackson sees no logic in this movie. He's like, I just want to kill him. I'm going to kill something, damn it. So, they lure Kong at night. They set up, like, fire traps and napalm, and somehow that lures Kong out. Oh, yeah, when Loki and Marvel go up on the ridge, and then Kong shows up and is like, what's up? That's when Sam Jackson's group kind of, like, springs the fire trap, and Kong kills a bunch of his guys, and then, like, just passes out for some reason. I don't know why. And while he's passed out, they're setting up charges, massive explosive charges around Kong. They're just gonna blow him up like a dead whale on a beach. Look up that YouTube video. And meanwhile, the big one, the big skull crawler, comes out, and not for nothing, it didn't seem much bigger than anything else, any of the other skull crawlers. Kong wakes up at this point, kills Sam Jackson before Sam Jackson can blow him up. Because at this point, Loki has showed up. You know, he's already once said to... The reason why Loki has his group on the boat and Sam Jackson has his group setting up all these bombs is because Loki's like, let me take these civilians and we're going that way. You can stay here and do what you want. We're going that-a-way. So then he comes back and basically tries to appeal to Sam Jackson again. And the kid that helped them, the mechanic kid that helped them start the boat, goes AWOL, turns on Sam Jackson, and points the gun at him like, dude, like, stand down, Colonel. And all the other, and it, basically everyone else in Sam Jackson's group is like, this is stupid, this is crazy, we're all going to die. But they were following orders. They didn't want to, be insubordinate or be accused of insurrection. And not following orders. But basically, as soon as one guy turns, everyone else is like, yeah, man, Colonel, this is stupid. We're not going to do this anymore. So, like I said, then the lizard shows up, and it goes from night to day like that. It's suddenly daytime! Kong, long story short, Kong defeats the king skull crawler. And literally just walks away. Like, that's the whole thing. Like, Kong shows up and leaves. Like, he was... It's a perfect example of Kong was Sam Jackson's white whale. You know, Ahab's white whale. And just like that, the white whale kills him at some point. Spoilers, if you haven't read that book. And at the end of it all, a bunch of people, I'm like, what was the point? Again, I'm like, what was the point of that? Did we go there to kill King Kong? Did we go there to capture him? Were we just going to tag, just tag him and put a satellite tracker in him and release him back into the wild? Why were we there? I don't get it. I don't understand. Other, and I was right about this, to establish that he is in fact in the same universe as the 2014 Godzilla movie. Because, and I had nothing tipped me off of this, the thing that I read didn't say that it was a post-credit scene, but it was. I was like, roll your credits. I will sit here and watch. Credits rolled. You know, the survivors get back home, including John C. Reilly, which that was kind of sweet. Because John C. Reilly's character, he's like, yeah, my son was born like a month after I was deployed. I haven't been home in 28 years. You know, this. You know, I have my son is a man. You know, there's a man now that I gave birth to that doesn't know me. And my wife is probably remarried and you know, so and you know, moved on with her life. And it was really sweet that he shows up home. He's got flowers in his hand. He's got his duffel bag. Knocks on the door, and this guy, obviously a young man, answers the door and kind of like, "Who are you?" And backs away, and then the wife comes in holding a tray of drinks and drops it, and you know she's crying and she hugs him, and you know then it's really sweet. And at one point he's sitting down with a hot dog and a beer. He references that earlier. He's like, you know, nothing is as happy as hot dog and a beer watching a Cubs game. And so that was sweet. And then the rest of the credits roll. And at the very end, Loki and Marvel are at some facility. They don't say if it's government or not or if it's private. Like, Monarch is the company that John Goodman worked for. His associate survived. And so did the Asian girl that was with them, the other scientist. And now they're talking the same exact thing that John Goodman was. Like, it's like, would you, it's like, long before man, you know, we don't own this planet. These gods do. These giant monsters, these giant creatures that have been here long before we have. They own this planet. Again, nobody asked, well, where'd they go? So it's like, we're just visiting. We're on their territory. You know, Kong is one of them. And then there's also these. And they show a slideshow. And it's Godzilla. And Rodan. And Mothra. And Ghidorah. Or Ghidorah, depending on how you pronounce it. So, they set it up now for Godzilla versus King Kong. But not only that, Godzilla and Mothra, Rodan, and Ghidorah. I don't know how far they're going to go with that. I don't know if this is going to gain any real legs. And the very last thing in the movie is it cuts back to black and you hear Godzilla's roar. So, yeah, they've established that there are all these other monsters. So, there we go. I don't know why it took so long to get to that point. I don't know why they went to the island. King Kong did, I mean, he killed a bunch of lizard things and broke a bunch of helicopters. I mean, he was literally just minding his own business through the entire movie. Like, you can't fault this guy for killing all these soldiers and scientists. You're trespassing. You broke and entered into my house and tried to blow me up. Twice. You know, you tried to shoot me up with a helicopter. Of course I'm going to kill you. He's just minding his own damn business and killing these creatures. I mean, it's weird because, like, in all versions of King Kong, in the three King Kong movies up to now, it's like, we're going to this island. It's basically, we're going to this island to get a giant monkey. We don't know what's there, but we're going there, and we're going to find something crazy. This movie, like, again, it's never really, John Goodman never really establishes if he actually knows there's a giant monkey there. But he goes there. And if he does know the giant monkey is there, it's never fully established. Are they there to record the giant monkey, kill the giant monkey, or capture the giant monkey? It's never established. And if they were going to capture it, what was the, you know, I don't get, you know, they didn't have the equipment to do that. It was like either a bag it, tag it, or and release it, or it was a kill mission. I don't know. It seems like he was going to, because when at the very beginning of the movie, John Goodman's talking to this guy on Capitol Hill, the senator or something. He's like, yeah, we're hoping to find natural resources and things that we can use, either for war efforts or just for America. We're trying to find things. So what was he going to do? I don't know. I don't know. What? Why did he do that? Why was he doing it? I don't get it. Ah, dang it. Now I'm mad. Now I'm mad at the movie. This movie wasn't good. A lot of people died just needlessly for no real reason. It was just like, we're establishing that there's a giant monkey, but now that we're on this island, we have to make it interesting. We have to get to the other side of the island, and we're going to go with a crazy colonel. And like, I don't know what the point of this movie was other than to set up Godzilla versus King Kong versus Godzilla and other monster movies. I don't know. I don't care anymore. So, in conclusion, I saw Kong Skull Island, and I thought it was crap. The acting was okay in it. Like, I liked Tom Hiddleston. I liked Brie Larson. I liked John Goodman. I liked John C. Reilly. Those are the only actors I really liked. Actually, the kid, the mechanic kid, I kind of liked him. That's it. You know, there weren't really any great performances. I mean, those guys were good. They were okay. But, I mean, the story was stupid. And there were a lot of holes in it, the things that didn't make sense, and things that took too long to explain. And I guess, I mean, it was pretty nicely shot. The cinematographer was very artistic in many regards. Like, you get some really good shots. The cinematography was great. I'll give it that. It was really good. And the graphics were good. The music was forgettable. I can't even remember if there was, like, a theme at any point. Because usually there's like, an underlying repeating musical theme. I don't think there was in this movie. I mean, there was music. Oh, and they played so many songs, kind of like in Suicide Squad, where they play the first half of a verse to establish the mood, and then like it moves on from there. Like, there are so many songs that got started, and then we didn't really hear much of it in quick succession. Like, every time they have to do anything, like they walk around with a turntable, and they throw on a record. Like, every time they're setting something up, so. Yeah, this movie wasn't really that great. I can't even recommend it as a monster movie. Yeah, Kong fights these giant lizard things, but they're... You know when you're... You know... There's usually a point where, in a giant monster fight, where there's obviously... Like, one side is obviously winning, or one side is getting exhausted. But, like, these things... Like, no matter how much punching, how much damage, like, Kong seemed to get injured, like, ah, ow, that hurt. Kong seemed to get injured, but these lizard things never did. Like, they didn't feel pain until you crushed their heads in or ripped out their insides through their mouth. That was weird, by the way. Yeah, Kong, like, he has the girl, and also this, he has a very human understanding of things, and, like, instead of just seeing people and being freaked out by them, like, he walks up to people and is like, Yeah, you're not a dick. Okay, you're cool. And then walks away from people. There's other people he looks at like, well, F you, man! And just punches, you know. At one point, he saves Brie Larson from the water. By the way, she falls in like, I thought it was like maybe 10 feet of water. She falls, she like sinks for like 30 feet in this water. And Kong saves her. And he's holding her, and then, like, the giant, the big one, the big lizard thing, sees that there's something in Kong's hands, like, well, I want that! And, like, grabs it with its tongue, and pulls it into his mouth, and he's, like, now trying to eat, like, Kong's fist and arm. And I don't know what happens next, because, like, it's not like Kong has a free hand, it's holding Brie Larson, but he somehow, like, prolapses the esophagus, and like he just pulls his arm out, and like every like half of its internal organs come out its mouth too, and that's how Kong beats this thing, is it rips internal organs out through its mouth without actually holding on to them, because he's holding on to Brie. I don't know. It was really weird. I'm like, oh, he's in trouble now. Oh, ew, that's okay. Oh, all right, well, that solves that problem. It's like they were running out of time. By the way, that fight with that big one lasted like 15 minutes. That was a long fight. That thing would not give up, and neither would Kong. For the longest time, it was ridiculous. So that's what I mean. Like, I got bored because, all right, he's just fine. You know, it's people going through this jungle. That's all they're doing. They're just walking through the jungle. The movie tries to keep it interesting by killing people by giant bugs at some point, every so often. And then, like, these... But all Kong does is he eats, drinks, and fights these giant lizards. That's all he does. And then he gets bored and just walks away. He's like, all right, done. And walks away. He saves Brie Larson's life, looks at her, he's like, all right, puts her down, walks away. And then, you know, Loki runs over and doesn't do anything. Just, like, brings her up to a sitting position, and she coughs up water. Like, he doesn't even, like, do CPR or anything. Yeah. So anyway, this movie got boring, and I didn't really care for it. I didn't think it was that great. It wasn't even a good monster movie. Like, giant monster movie with monsters fighting each other. It really wasn't that great. It definitely falls in line with the Godzilla movie, because the Godzilla movie wasn't that great. It wasn't. It was longer than it needed to be, and it was boring. And all of it, again, was just to set up all these other giant monsters and a Godzilla, a King Kong vs. Godzilla movie. So, I feel like you could have done better with this, setting that up. Anyway, that's that. This movie wasn't that great. I don't recommend it. If you're gonna watch it, like, rent it. So, yeah, don't worry about going and seeing this movie. I believe there's something coming out next week. What is it? Can't think of it. If there's nothing next week, at the very least, the following week, Power Rangers come out, and I will be reviewing that. So anyway, maybe I'll see you next week for a new movie. If not, I'll see you in 2 weeks for Power Rangers. Anyway, that's that, people. Talk to you later.